Hey, brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick here in North Carolina. I hope you guys are doing all right. I'm just trying to firm up my schedule. I have a few videos to make tonight, but first I want to make one about the schedule. It looks like the Lord is leading me not to go to Ohio at this time. I'm waiting on a finalized, the Lord had given me a word that He would open up churches to me. But since I started my ministry, I mean, I work with churches. I planted churches. I've gone to lots of churches, and they just not that I'm John the Baptist, but when you have a John the Baptist type ministry, it's just like those people that are running for the Republican Party who are the Tea Party people. You're running against the establishment, and the establishment always becomes corrupt. It's just all the denominations basically, but it's a mission creep. The establishment moves toward greater and greater corruption as tradition develops and builds. So it would just make common sense that the Catholic Church has the most baggage of man-made corruption, and in every denomination. I've made videos about that in the past. Denominations, brothers and sisters, start as usually, now there's cults and all that, and I don't even consider them denominations, but like Jehovah's Witnesses as an example, Mormonism, Seventh-day Adventists, these groups that started by false prophets. I'm not talking about that because there are false prophets, but there are real prophets of God, real apostles. They really fall in the category of an apostle, like John Wesley, these kind of guys who started the Methodist Church. All of these denominations were started as a move of God. God was doing something unique in a certain place, in a certain generation, in a certain time. So in other words, God moved mightily in 1850s, in New York City, businessman revival. I think it was 1859. It swept the whole nation. Started by businessmen up there in New York City. Imagine that. Just prior to the Civil War. Well, we can look in hindsight if we want to see why God did that. Millions of people got saved just prior to the start of the Civil War. So lots of people that died during the Civil War who would have went to hell had gotten saved by that great revival is one example. God was trying to send revival probably to stop the Civil War and all the things that caused it, to do away with all those things and make changes, of course. All of those things didn't happen. We did have a Civil War, but, as I said, the number one thing is people got saved. Millions of people got saved. So, as a result of one of those kind of a thing, as an example, there's denominations that come out of those moves of God. And then they're still talking about what God, the message that God had 200 years ago or 300 years ago. Of course, the gospel's still the same. That's the problem. When you start talking to these old dead religious people, they'll say, well, of course, give me that old-time religion. Yes, we're talking the gospel and all that's still the same. And, on the other extreme, we're not talking Joel Osteen where you keep, grinning and smiling and being relevant in that way. We're not talking about that, brothers and sisters. The Lord always has me dealing with those two sides. The greasy gracers and the Judaizers and the relevant. You see these churches with the youth pastor. He's wearing jeans and he's wearing one of these, like a button-down shirt that's with his shirt tail out, and it's got like a big cross with a kind of a Celtic-looking cross-looking thing on it. On the back, it's kind of like a cowboy shirt-looking thing. He's got his hair all greased up and slicked back, and maybe even he's wearing cowboy boots, or he's wearing some kind of he's dressed like a teenager or whatever. Maybe some of the young people, and this guy's, middle-aged. I've seen that all over the United States. These guys who are trying to be cool and be relevant and all this kind of stuff. There's a difference, being relevant in the flesh and being relevant in the fact that God has a message in each place, with each group. You're talking to young people, God might have something different to say than what He says to middle-aged people, old people, whatever. God has a different word in New York City than He would probably have in Houston, Texas. Not necessarily, but generally speaking, God has you have to have the right word in the right place at the right time. As you're led by the Spirit. Not all these man-made conferences and dogmas and, as I mentioned before many times, they have this evangelism explosion that came from Coral Gables, Florida, the late Dr. D. James Kennedy. He developed a methodology to growing churches, not necessarily people getting saved. But the focus of it was to grow his church to 10,000 members. And I mean, that's really what happened. And so every church, even the church I was working as an altar worker while I was going to Bible college, It used to be called First Assembly of God of Winston-Salem. All those churches now, they dropped those names. It's got some other kind of name now. It's not even mentioned in like church. And then there's, as a matter of fact, there's an apostolic church. It was called Christ Temple in Winston-Salem also that I visited a few times. And some of the pastors got up there. I mean, I like their preaching. Some of the preachers got up there and said, if you're not baptized in the name of Jesus, you're not saved. And that's the false doctrine from the apostolic movement or Pentecostal oneness and all those guys. I don't have a problem with them over-exalting Jesus. You cannot over-exalt Jesus. The debate about the Trinity and all that, you know, Jesus is God. You know, but I believe the standard interpretation that there is a Trinity that's held by the vast majority of the church. But this is one of them things that's a mystery, okay, and people are arguing over it. That's not the point, because you cannot over-exalt Jesus, and Jesus is not a lesser God. He is God, fully God, just as much as God the Father and God the Holy Spirit. Okay. But the problem with some of the apostolic preachers in those churches, Pentecostal oneness, is they say if you're not baptized in the name of Jesus, you're not saved by the work of baptism instead of baptism as a result of your salvation. But not all of them say that. There are some that believe just like I do, which is kind of along the lines of Assemblies of God, Church of God, along in that vein, that, you know, you're saved by grace or you're saved through faith, not of your own, but a gift of God, not by works, lest any man should boast. So anyway, they even changed their name. And, that, you know, your apostolic movement and your Pentecostal oneness people, they're really extreme hardcore. You know, they, you know, you're getting into the almost to the snake handling people. Now, they are out of a branch here in the mountains of North Carolina. They're snake handlers. I mean, I'm talking about extreme of, you know, in all areas where women have to wear a dress and below their knee and no makeup and, you know, all of those things that are also outward appearance besides our inward holiness, but also an outward sanctification holiness. Lots of rural areas in the mountains of North Carolina and other places have these still, you know, practice that. These cultural sanctification too, you know, whatever, and public sanctification. The way they dress, women wearing dresses, etc. But anyway, even that church, which I would consider probably, that, you know, I would think would be the last place you would see, they changed their name from Christ Temple to something else. I forgot what it is. It's something like community. They put something like community. They might say church in there. Community something. Whatever. They totally changed the name and watered it down. They removed it. And Christ Temple is not so, you know, it's not even Jesus Christ. Just Christ Temple, which was not really that powerful to start with. But Christ was in there. Anyway, brothers and sisters, that's where we're at. So when, you know, when the Lord would send somebody like me, and there's others also, who are not, brothers and sisters, it's not a point about being dogmatic. Let me say this too, and I mentioned about politics. Let me just give an example. I'm not following politics that much. I didn't follow it really hardly at all since I've been a pastor, only in the fact that I'm looking at the end time stuff. I used to follow politics more before I became a pastor, so the year 2000. But anyway, I know a little bit. And I have relatives who are really into it who are not Christians. So they talk to me about it all the time. And so I would say this. Dennis Kucinich, as an example, I wouldn't agree with anything the man says, if you know what I'm talking about, if you follow politics. And then you got Ron Paul on the libertarian side. Dennis Kucinich is the liberal side, but also a libertarian in a way. I believe that those two guys, Ron Paul and Dennis Kucinich, have true core value beliefs and convictions, and they're willing to stand on those without pleasing people. There may be some of the only two politicians that I can think of, and that's actually how they feel. They are not a greasy used car salesman politician, and there may be a few others. There's another one from North Carolina too, and maybe who's a congressman from down near the coastal area of North Carolina who seems pretty good too. I think his name is Johnson or something like that. Anyway, very few, brothers and sisters, very few. There's just a few congressmen and senators. So the same thing is true in the ministry. There are people, and I've listened to them because people have this big debate, like this most famous preacher on YouTube. I can think of people say, oh, is he pre-trib? Is he post-trib? Is he mid-trib? And there's a big kick about all that, what the guy believes. Come to find out, people can produce videos where the guy's saying he's pre-trib, and when he's in front of a pre-trib crowd, he's saying he's mid-trib when he's in front of a mid-trib crowd. He's post-trib when he's, in a post-trib radio show. So people won't take a stand. And, I mean, that's really, you know, the thing that, you know, you can have popularity. I can make videos like when, you know, just like myself, brothers and sisters, I was thinking about today. When I make a video and I talked about the sudden destruction coming. I don't mention the rapture. I got dozens of people who are post-tribbers who love my video. They never seen my videos before. They saw that destruction, and for some reason, brothers and sisters, I'll tell you, that bothers me. A lot of these post-tribbers, they're like taking delight in destruction, which is really weird and really bizarre, and we need to pray for them. People who are taking delight in destruction, and they want to hear more about it so they can say, yeah, kill those evil people. Not having enough humility to realize that if it wasn't for the grace of God, they would be in the same boat. And so, you know, it's only the God called them and delivered them and chose them and set them free, or they would also be doomed to destruction, as Paul said, you know, Romans, where is that where he says, or is it? You know, how can the potter say to the clay, why did you make me this way? You know, and so some vessels are for honor, some vessels for dishonor, some for destruction and some for, you know, glory, immortality. So, brothers and sisters, you know, we have to be humble about all this. But there is times when we can stand. And what I was saying is if I made that video and I don't take a stand on any doctrine, and I'm just going forward, plowing through, and just tickling people's ears to, like, you know, it's the greatest example probably in modern America, Joel Osteen. You're just tickling ears and driving forward and grinning and smiling and trying to win a popularity contest and be a people pleaser. And that's the problem I've had with pastors since I started in the ministry in the Philippines and in the U.S. It's people pleasing. People pleasing. Building their own kingdom, or building, and even if they're selflessly not building their own kingdom, they're building the denomination. They're building, you know, their mentor's kingdom. You know, lots of people, they you know, one of those false doctrines, you know, is this a covering issue? Whereas we're covered by the blood of Jesus, not by any man. We're not covered by a man. We're covered by the blood of Jesus. That's just another tool used by religion to control people. Anyway, brothers and sisters, I am getting into all that now, aren't I? Anyway, brothers and sisters, when you're willing to take a stand, you know, and say, hey, I believe in a pre-trib rapture, you know, you're limiting your audience. When I take a stand and say, hey, I believe the Bible clearly teaches holiness, as I read from the same text about the rapture that Paul talks about, 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, he talks about holiness and sanctification, setting yourselves apart, being called to holiness and sanctification. So, brothers and sisters, we are called to that. When I start saying that I believe in the baptism of the Holy Spirit with evidence of speaking in tongues, you know, there's other people. You know, the majority of Christians, even today, is not into, you know, accepting that part of the gospel, the full gospel. That's why they call it full gospel. People that believe in the baptism of the Holy Spirit and sanctification and all that, they're called full gospel. As an example, not the charismatics. Charismatics are people that go to regular churches, came out in the 1970s, or late 60s, early 70s, and all these denominations, they have people that speak in tongues, but they stay in these old dead denominations. You know, they don't get into holiness and sanctification and all this kind of stuff. They're still trying to mix the new wine with the old traditions is what's really going on. And, you know, they're tolerated in some denominations. But anyway, brothers and sisters, you know, God has his reasons for doing all those things and allowing all those things up to the Lord. But anyway, brothers and sisters, I got these other videos to make, so I better wrap this video up. That wasn't my intention. I want to talk about my itinerary, the traveling I'll be doing. But brothers and sisters, we have to be willing to take a stand, even if people don't like it or they do like it or what. We have to be instant in season and out of season. Brothers and sisters, if you want that, I'm going to always be doing that. By the grace of God, you know, I don't want to sell out and compromise as much as humanly possible. Nobody's perfect. I want to maintain you know, to be preaching for a one-man audience. And as I said in the video the other day, you know, sometimes people put on comments and it shows up on Google and then they'll back down and take it down before it comes out on YouTube. But I can still see the comments on Google Plus. As an example, when I made the joke in my last video about these people who are think it's Christianity and think it's preaching and think it's that they're calling themselves a prophet, they're looking at the lines in the back of Obama's old wrinkled head and thinking they're seeing an upside down alien. And I talked about that. It's really a large group of people that believe that and are looking at that. And it's really to the point of mental illness, actually, and paranoia and schizophrenia. and so bizarre, especially when you try to call it some type of Christianity, some type of something from the, you know, like it's from the Bible or something. I stepped on a few toes with that. And like I said, brothers and sisters, if you, you know, and I'm saying these things, I mean, I need to clarify this on every video because some people don't see, and of course, every video. I'm saying these things not for my about me or myself, but for you, brothers and sisters. You have to, you want to, you know, walk in the power of God. You want God to pour out His power on you and use you to, you know, to lay hands on people and be healed and speak in tongues and the gift of prophecy, words of wisdom, all this kind of stuff. You got to have faith. You got to have some backbone. You got to have some spine. I mean, you got to grow up in the faith. You got to get off the old breast milk and get on to the meat of things here. You got to grow up and mature. And that's really the problem, the immaturity, and I've said this before, you know, I'm trying to, you know, the Lord is leading me to say it more directly, not the, oh, yeah, you know, an old, grinning Joel Osteen type of way of saying it. Of course, Joel Osteen don't even say it, even with a grin. He don't even speak the truth with a, I'm speaking the truth, you see, with a joke, but I'm trying to speak directly to you now a little more aggressively because our time is short. You know, brothers and sisters, you have to, you know, as I made the video about Moses, just like Moses, when God said, hey, Moses, from the burning bush, God said, hey, Moses, I want you to go back to the people, and I'm going to use you to deliver the people. And Moses, instead of saying, yeah, okay, God, I can do all things through Yahweh who strengthens me, or okay, God, you're going to do it and you're going to use me, and I know you got the power to do it. And instead of saying those things, the big mistake that Moses made was he said, well, you know, I stutter, you know, I can't speak good, and you know, you really got the wrong guy, and you know, go find somebody else. I mean, basically it's what Moses was telling God. So when lots of people who message me, they have all similar excuses to what Moses has. Instead of looking to what God can do, they look at what they can do. And brothers and sisters, I'm trying to be more direct about it with you. You know, we have to give an account to the Lord, each one of us. So I think that people make the mistake. That's the thing about it. People are thinking at the wrong level. Like when, and I was just thinking about this while I was praying this a little while ago. People are thinking in such a non-spiritual level. They're thinking in a carnal level. When I'm sitting up here telling you these things, like I've just said, about what I'm doing, I'm not saying it so you'll say, okay, this is what Patrick's doing. No. I'm telling you this as an example of what, you know, I'm giving you the wisdom and philosophy and understanding of the Word of God that God gave me so that you can see it as an example unto yourself. Instead of sitting here thinking of it in a natural way, in a carnal way, think of it in a spiritual way, or turn it on yourself and say, hey, you know, how does this apply to me? How does this affect me? And, you know, what can I do with this information, you know, to take it forward? So, brothers and sisters, that's what I'm trying to give you tonight. And I have two more videos. The Lord had given me a word just now, just before I started this video. I was praying, and I usually pray before I make the videos, so I can try to get fresh manna from the Lord. That's the secret to getting fresh manna. Give us this day our daily bread, right? The manna that's a day old goes bad. You have to have, give us this day our daily bread. Just like when the children of Israel got manna from in the desert. Once it was a day old, it went bad. Except for on Saturday, the Sabbath. They collected enough for 2 days, and then on the day before, and then they didn't go out on the Sabbath. Anyway, brothers and sisters, let me end this video. Let me stay here on the end. Because if you've been watching this, I will be, by the grace of God, the Lord is leading me not to go to Ohio. I will go to West Virginia, Charles Point, West Virginia. You need to contact me, Sister Holly. I think it's West Virginia WV who comments on almost every video that I make. She's below here. You can contact her too. She's my point of contact there. For West Virginia, that's going to be July the 19th and the 20th. Okay, then I will be back in Asheville, North Carolina for 2 or 3 days. I will be in Asheville, North Carolina. I'm not there now, so I won't really say I'm back. I'll be back in North Carolina until from the 21st to the morning of the 24th. Contact me if you're in the mountains, Cherokee, Asheville area of North Carolina, the border area. Then I'll be going from there, brothers and sisters, on the 24th. I will be in Nashville, Tennessee for one night only. Contact me. Sister Linda is going to be my point of contact there in Nashville, and their brother Cody for Christ. We're supposed to meet there, also in Nashville, Tennessee. Then from there, I will be heading, passing through Memphis, Little Rock, going into Dallas. If you're along the way, near the highway there, you can contact me or what. Maybe I will, we can make arrangements. I can stay another day somewhere in between Nashville and Dallas, on my way to Dallas. I'll be in Dallas for a few days, and then I'll be going up, brothers and sisters. I don't know the exact date yet. I'll be going to Portland. I will be in Portland, Oregon. I will be there, and then I will be for 2 or 3 days over a weekend. I'll be in Seattle for 2 or 3 days, and I will be in the Vancouver area, and there's a lake about an hour and a half east of Vancouver. I forgot the name of it. I think it's called Chadwick or something like that. Anyway, there's a lake and a campground there. I'll be there. And that area, I think, instead of the city of Vancouver, I've got different groups of people trying to work that out right now. That will all be just immediately. So the end of July, first 2 weeks of August, I will be in the Portland, Vancouver, and Seattle area. Please get in touch with me. The Lord is leading me and talking to me. I've got people in the Northeast, brothers and sisters. There is a church just across the river in New Jersey. I think that I'm supposed to be going up there. They're giving me a final okay. As I mentioned, this whole video is about that. You know, my okay to preach, even though I'm ordained, my ordination truly comes from the Lord. I care not what any assembly of men would say. But brothers and sisters, if they invite me, I know the Lord wants me to go. I will go there, and I will speak the truth boldly. As boldly as the Holy Spirit will give me the utterance to speak, and that will be just across the river, just out a suburb of Newark, New Jersey, and then also in New York City. I'm waiting for the final date. I'm going to try and line those up. So I may be doing that right after I come back from the Pacific Northwest, or maybe even before. It's getting pretty late. I don't think they're going to do that to me. I think it'll be at the end of August, brothers and sisters. I'll be back in the Northeast, New York and New Jersey. Praise God for those opportunities and those windows. And it's up to the Lord. If He opens them, I'm going. If He doesn't open them, that's also cool with me. I'm into whatever the Lord wants me to do. And He's the one to make a way for you and me. And then when, you know, that's the thing about it. You have to offer yourself as a living sacrifice, like Romans chapter 12, verse 1. You know, offer yourself as a living sacrifice, and God will give you, He'll open the door for you. Whatever it is, to evangelize your neighbor, you know, to talk to somebody at work, whatever. Let the Lord be the one to open the door. But you first have to say, hey, Lord, here I am. You know, open the door. Lord, I'm ready to go forward. Just, give me one fish today, Lord. Use me to catch one fish today, Lord. Now start from there. That's what you have to do. You know, Lord, give me the wisdom and the opportunity and the avenue and the words to lead one person to the Lord. Start like that. God bless you guys.